Good morning and a warm welcome to the 20th meeting of the Constitution Europe External Affairs and Culture Committee in 2023. Today we have received apologies from Maurice Golden, MSP, and our colleague Mark Ruskell is joining us remotely. Our first agenda item is a decision on taking business in private. Are members content to take agenda item 3 in private? Thank you. And agenda item 2 is our continued evidence session on committee's inquiry into the Scottish Government's national outcomes and indicators relating to international policy. And we're delighted to be joined this morning by Shona Shand, International Trade Director of the Scottish Chambers of Commerce, Vicky Miller, Director of Marketing and Digital at Visit Scotland, Gareth Williams, Head of Policy, Scottish Council for Development and Industry, and also Anthony Salomani, Managing Director of the European Merchants. And a warm welcome to you all. I wonder if I could open with a kind of introductory question. I've lifted it from Ms. Shand's evidence to the committee, and again, thank you for those who've completed written submissions to the committee. You mentioned that we punch above our weight on global stage. However, as our competitors step up their game and an uncertain world of migration, business and investment and travel evolves, we need to shift up a gear. So I'm interested in that gear shift, but I'm also interested in finding out if everyone shares those as the main challenges going forward in terms of the work that the Scottish Government is doing. So I wonder, Ms. Shand, if you want to go first.
Yes, certainly, no problem. Well, firstly, thank you very much for the opportunity to be here this morning. It's a very important inquiry for us, and I think for Scottish businesses as well. So moving up a gear, I think, is very important, and we know that because we have feedback directly from the businesses that we support. So through our 30 local chambers of commerce, we directly support around 13,000 businesses, but there are about 350,000 businesses in Scotland. And the feedback we have from them is very much when it comes to trade around some of the challenges that they face. So the red tape, the barriers, and particularly over the past few years, obviously we've had the dreaded COVID pandemic. We've left the European Union, and that's caused even more lack of stability for businesses when they're looking at going global. So stability is something that they're very much concerned about, understanding what the future holds, where the markets are. So at the moment, we very much align to most of the 15 top markets in a trading nation, with Scottish Government paper, and particularly with those markets and with the sectors which are most prevalent. But there's some really good research out there that shows that there are some up-and-coming markets that I think we need to be getting ahead of the game. So the Oxford Economics paper recently spoke about emerging middle classes and some of the opportunities there. So I think while it's right and reasonable that the likes of SDI concentrate with the top 1,200 companies on the top 15 markets and the top sectors, actually, we don't want to be left behind. We, the business community, really need not to be left behind. Particularly with the move to net zero, there are going to be some supply chain challenges as well. So we feel as a business organisation we can really help the Scottish Government to be ahead of the game. So by 2030, some of these markets, which are going to be really prevalent and really of importance to Scottish businesses, we can be helping to pave the way now rather than trying to exhaust the current markets. Actually, let us help you get ahead.
OK, thank you. Does anyone else want to talk about some of the challenges, Vicky?
I would agree. I think on the travel side of things, as we've emerged from COVID, obviously the travel landscape has been extremely competitive, and many other nations investing significantly in the promotion of their destination to attract the people that are travelling. And bearing in mind kind of pressure on individual household budgets, we obviously want to get to the people that can afford to travel. And from a kind of an economic perspective, international visitors are, although smaller in volume, are hugely important in terms of value. They contribute over 43% of the kind of 11 billion that the tourism economy is worth. So spend per international visitor is four times more, for example, what a domestic visitor would spend. So in terms of sustainable recovery, actually attracting international visitors to Scotland is extremely important. And I think we just need to be very mindful that we are competing in a very competitive landscape with countries like Ireland, who are investing significantly to raise profile and attract, you know, their share. And they are obviously a key competitor. Obviously, pressures, cost of doing business pressures on the industry. Our role is to find ways where we can help them to trade internationally, so helping connect them with, for example, tour operators, travel agents internationally as a kind of cost-effective way to internationalise their business, reach new audiences and new markets. And we obviously look for affordable opportunities for businesses to do that so that they can capitalise on the opportunity.
Thank you. Mr. Williams, you want to?
Thank you, and I apologise to the committee that I wasn't able to send a written submission to you. I would agree with the point that we need to step up a gear. We hear through our International Business Committee about increasing competition. We've got the US Inflation Reduction Act, and then the EU response through the EU Green Deal. And there's no doubt that those are proving very attractive to businesses, and there is a risk that we will find that those very large markets with the major opportunities there will pull in an increasing share of investment and skills and assets. So we have the competition there. We also have competition for talent as well, and in a digital world, we increasingly hear about people able to locate themselves anywhere and work anywhere, which makes it even more challenging at times to attract people to Scotland. And we do need more entrepreneurs here. We need more managers to help grow our businesses. We need more people with the skills that our industries require to grow. We've also had, obviously, departure from the EU and significant changes in the trading environment for many businesses, new frictions that have been created. We welcome the Windsor Agreement, and that has certainly helped. And we heard that when we were in Brussels recently. But still, plenty of challenges there. And I agree with Shona's point around about new markets as well, and looking further ahead. There is always going to be a balance to be struck between the priorities that we have now in our largest markets, and then the opportunities that will be created in sub-Saharan Africa and so on, as their populations and cities and industries continue to grow. And then lastly, obviously, we have the climate issue, and we have inclusivity issues as well, and those are obviously causing some concerns around the impact of trade, and there is certainly a need to address those issues. So thank you.
Mr. Salamone.
Thank you, convener, and good morning. I think there are three core points I'd like to offer from my perspective as more of an academic stroke think tanker aside my industry colleagues. I think one is that we think about trade in the wider context of what's going on in external affairs policy or foreign policy, which is to say that there are other dimensions which are becoming more salient. So, for instance, national security and trade. We can look at other countries in Europe and the rest of the world who are reevaluating who they want to trade with, not solely on the basis of economic considerations, but also of strategic and geopolitical considerations as well. And obviously, Scotland is not responsible for the foreign policy of the United Kingdom, but nevertheless, when we're thinking about how Scotland trades with the rest of the world, it is worth keeping in mind those other factors, even though that might be challenging for business, in a sense, in adapting to new ways of working. If we look at a country like Germany, for instance, which of course is not, the same size as Scotland, a country which trades significantly with China but has just published a new national security strategy and is, weighing the implications of being so intertwined with a country like China in terms of the geopolitical context. Second, and related to that, is the question of the role of values in trade. So I mentioned national security, and I'm sure that's also there. But what do we want to say if Scotland is going to have a values-based external affairs policy or even a values-based trade policy? Now, that's not about discounting the economic consequences in terms of we still want trade investment in Scotland, we still want high-quality jobs and so forth. But in terms of how do we put that into practice? So, for instance, is it the case that we want to make economic or financial decisions which prioritise or balance some considerations over others? For instance, is it worth Scotland as a country wanting to trade more with fellow democracies as opposed to authoritarian regimes? Now, again, that's not necessarily the way in which we view trade and commerce perhaps in the past, but is it the way that we want to put values into practice? Because on the one hand, we can say that we have a values-based approach to engaging with the world, but then still we trade with anyone and anyone, anyone and everyone. That's, I'm not saying I have an answer on that question, but I think it's a question that should be posed. My third point and final point on this particular aspect is that when we're thinking about how Scotland trades with the world, of course, we can't divorce that from the multi-level aspect. We've heard Ireland mentioned before. Sure, and Ireland is a sovereign state. Scotland, of course, is not. So the extent to which actors at the UK government level and Scottish government level can work together productively is quite important to the trading and investment environment for Scotland.
Okay. Thank you very much. I'm going to open to questions from my colleagues. I could invite Mr. Bibby first. Thanks.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to the panel. Very much agree with what's been said there about going up a gear in terms of Scotland remaining competitive. Scottish Government has said they want Scotland to be better connected, and I think that's something that's shared across Parliament. We've heard also difficulty in measuring outcomes and some concerns raised about a lack of indicators. I just wanted to ask you whether you thought we are getting the basics right in terms of what we are monitoring and measuring in terms of our international work. For example, on the number of visitors coming to Scotland. So it was struck there what Ms Miller said there about the spend of international visitors being four times the amount of those of domestic visitors. And it was encouraging to hear recently from the Tourism Minister, Richard Lockhead, saying that actually visitor numbers are almost coming back to pre-COVID pandemic levels. So that's really encouraging. But if we do want to be better connected and we do want more people to come here and remain an attractive place to come, should we not have specific targets and outcomes relating to the number of visitors?
So I would say that the measures, in terms of our measurement framework, we focus on what we're calling four S's. So it's actually less about the number of visitors and it's more about the value per trip. And actually addressing issues that we have within the visitor economy around things like seasonality. So when I talk about the four S's, I'm talking about spread of visitors across Scotland, so that we get the balance of visitors right for every part of Scotland, and addressing obviously seasonal issues. Spend, as in the focus being spend per visitor, so it's about actually getting to the right visitors who are going to come here. Travel sustainably around Scotland, so thinking about the way that they might travel and the footprint that they leave, but also ensuring that they are the kind of visitors that will actually spend money in local economies, so that actually that that again it's that focus on the quality and the as I say the spending power once they're here. From a sustainability point of view, it's also then about looking at how we work collaboratively across Scotland to look at how we reduce the travel footprint. We're an island, people are going to fly into the country, but how do we ensure kind of more sustainable travel around Scotland and work as an industry collaboratively to become net zero? And then the satisfaction element are more the quality measures around the actual visitor experience, and that's the end-to-end visitor experience. So there are kind of four areas that we have created a bit of a measurement framework, and as I say, it's less about the volume, it's more about the value, and it's more about that equity across the country, and therefore that's about being very focused in our targeting of both audiences and markets in terms of who we're trying to attract into the country.
Thank you. Has any of the panel got any other thoughts on that?
I totally agree, and I think again the business community from an inward investment perspective is really important. So when we bring delegations across from across the globe to Scotland, they are here to look at some investment opportunities, but actually we also want them to become visitors and to bring family and friends in the future as well. So I would agree about the measurement principles. I think it's the quality-quantity conversation that we consistently have. So if we're bringing delegates across, we want to maybe spend 3 or 4 days in business, sort of B2B with them, but actually we always encourage our delegation to have an element of downtime and to not just maybe remain in one city in Scotland either. It's to view Scotland as a whole. It's very much a Team Scotland approach, and working with organisations like Team Scotland and talking up other sectors as well. So tourism as a whole is quite difficult, probably in as much as it takes in distilleries and it takes in transport, and it will take in other sectors as well. So we really need to continue to engage with the tourism sector to make sure that actually Scotland is seen globally as a place to visit, to invest, to business, and to come and study as well.
Would you want to comment on indicators more generally, or is it specifically tourism?
Mainly just like getting the basics right, and the example I thought was a number of tourists.
I think from our point of view, we welcomed the creation of the National Performance Framework. I think our members have always found it a bit hard to engage and monitor, and there are a lot of indicators in there. I suppose we have had conversation with the Scottish Government about the refresh, and we welcome the fact that they reached out to us for that. But what sort of struck me was that they wanted to talk about the outcome and the indicators specifically related to businesses. And obviously, we're an organisation with a wider membership, but even for a business or business organisation, there's a range of outcomes and indicators that businesses contribute to and have a strong interest in. So I think sometimes there's maybe a risk that we're kind of pigeonholing some of those conversations rather than joining them up. We had previously suggested that it would be worth looking at whether the indicators could be reframed so that they were measured as in a sort of distance to frontier way. So, take the example of the country or countries that are making most progress in a specific area, and how do we measure up to them on a scale of, say, 1 to 100? Because at present, it's difficult when you look across them to track the kind of progress that that Scotland's been making, and the international indicators do seem quite diverse and in need of some focus. So, for example, around population, I think the indicator is overall population, whereas I think there should be more priority given to working age population at this time, particularly given the kind of projections we have around increasing dependency ratios and so on. And then lastly, or just on the specific point about tourism, just to reinforce what's been said about the importance of that in relation to Scotland's soft power and the wider image and success of Scotland on the international stage.
Complete the circuit. Yes, I think that so there are two aspects of this for me, and I suppose it's not really surprising given my previous evidence to the Committee for Your International Affairs Inquiry that it's crucial that the Scottish Government, in terms of framing its own activities, has both strategic principles and objectives, but also targets, sure. But I think there's a difference between the existing kinds of targets, which my colleagues have spoken about in terms of specific outcomes in relation to trade, investment, and tourism, and so on, and so targets or objectives that frame the work of the Scottish Government as an entity in terms of its engagement with other governments, for instance. Is it worth whatever it's trying to achieve? Sometimes I'm not always as clear as what the objectives are, so I couldn't evaluate for you whether or not an outcome is being met or otherwise. So I think that's important because there are three elements of that. One is that it allows, if the Scottish Government does have a more strategic perspective overall, there are three benefits. One is it can prioritise where it's going to deploy its limited resources, and of course there is always going to be a limit on resources. Secondly, it ensures that there's appropriate delivery in terms of the government's work. And thirdly, it allows for that kind of measurability that you were speaking about. Now, in terms of the national outcomes itself, I know it's just the headline, but nevertheless it says we are open, connected, and make a positive contribution internationally. That's the international headline outcome. To me, that's quite vague. And again, I know that there's some data behind specific measures of what the Scottish Government is looking for, how they're being achieved or not, but I hope that this review is an opportunity to try and focalise this a bit more. Being open is wonderful, absolutely, but what does that really mean in practice? And I think if we link that through to other aspects of the Scottish Government's approach to external affairs, there's a big emphasis on being what's called a good global citizen. Now, again, I think that that sounds very admirable, but I cannot tell you exactly what that means in practice, and I think it's important to have that kind of detail at this stage.
Thanks for those answers. I do agree with you. It does come across as a bit vague, and you know, in terms of you know being better connected, we talked just there about the importance of attracting international visitors, and I hear what the panel said about value and not volume. But also, there's an issue about being connected and how people get here. And I know something that's been mentioned in the evidence about route development. And that's not just in terms of tourism, that's, of course, investment and trade as well. Again, I mean, I'm not saying everything's bad in that regard. I think there's been some positive developments recently in terms of a new flight, for example, from Edinburgh to the United States. But in terms, again, in terms of getting the basics right about being connected, would you agree that more direct flights between Scotland and the rest of the world would be beneficial in terms of, you know, tourism, trade and investment? And that should be part of an indicator in terms of the outcomes that we're looking at in terms of international work as well.
Absolutely. I would completely agree with that. And I think, you know, we've seen very strong evidence where, you know, when we had the direct flight previously, for example, from China, the Hainan flight, you know, we saw the immediate benefits in terms of the increase in visitor numbers pre-COVID. From China, taking it from, I don't know, I think over the kind of 10th position, I think, in terms of volume and value of visitors to being in the top five. So, you know, you absolutely see the direct impact of that increased connectivity.
And if I can just add a really good example, there are no direct flights from Scotland to India, and India is the greatest consumer of Scotch whisky. So if we're looking for investors, we're not making it easy for them to come here.
Yeah, I think some form of indicator would be helpful. I suppose you know, you would want to be prioritising those markets that are most economically significant rather than a measure all flights to international destinations, and you know, we have to be mindful of climate impact of that. I suppose we're still waiting for Transport Scotland's aviation strategy, and we'd want to ensure that an indicator was linked to the outcomes that are sought for that. And we're still waiting for the Strategic Transport Projects 2 delivery plan, which seems to have been pushed back and I think had a little bit less emphasis than previous STPR on connectivity in Scotland with our international gateways. I suppose you'd also want to be thinking about shipping and freight and so on, and connectivity if we were looking at indicators around that.
Maybe just briefly add that I suppose the question about flights and connectivity for Scotland links on some of the challenges that any country or state or sub-state needs to deal with, and that's the geographical challenges. I mean, I suppose we don't really think of Scotland or the UK being on the periphery of Europe, but in some measures that's true. And I suppose we could look to see how other countries are trying to cope with that, and if there's anything to be learned from that. So, for instance, Ireland and Iceland would probably be two examples of countries which are further on the periphery of Europe, and they have, in different measures, been able to turn themselves into places where aviation is a core part of both of their connection for themselves, but also how they connect other countries. So, for instance, on the feasibility of a flight, I mean, this is not my area of expertise, but just from my foreign policy perspective, of flights between Scotland and India, who would be interested in even providing that service? You know, that's a question for us to grapple with in terms of our where we sit in the rest of Europe and the world, geographically speaking, and how can we get around any challenges associated with that, as other countries have done.
Thank you for all the answers there. I've got one last question, I think, specifically for Visit Scotland. Obviously, mentioned there, I think, about limited resources from government and also the need to be competitive in terms of other countries and specifically Ireland. I just wondered, in terms of the outcomes, in terms of achieving more international high-value visitors, how do you get the balance between what you spend domestically in terms of advertising and marketing Scotland within Scotland itself and the UK? And I know during the pandemic or post-pandemic that was a particular issue versus, you know, that international marketing and advertising.
Yeah, I mean, obviously during the pandemic, our resources were focused on, well, two things. The domestic market, because of the ability to travel, but at the same time, you know, something like a global crisis like that is never a time for a country to go quiet. You've got to maintain your brand awareness and recognition. And so we continued to keep Scotland front of mind when people could travel. And I think that was really important to help support then that early recovery and some of the international figures that we've seen, obviously, from 22. Now we have pivoted the majority of our resources, and when I talk about that, our kind of media budgets, if you like, to international, clearly because of the scale of opportunity, the pent-up demand for travel, and the fact that we obviously do want to compete with other destinations to get our share of high-value visitors. We're very fortunate in that we have built a very strong digital presence for Scotland, so working with the industry to support businesses in the industry to be discoverable in the right channels, but also our own channels, so visitscotland.com, our social media presence. We have a huge reach through those channels, so what I would call our owned and earned activity and things like PR activity, for example. We have a PR team who are focused in different markets. They have very strong relationships with media in those markets. And, you know, we have a very proactive communication plan where we're constantly feeding stories about Scotland. And we do that on behalf of Team Scotland as well. So that is also, you know, very much with a visit focus, but also as a country, as a destination, and that kind of wider live, visit, work. So significant resources go into international because of the opportunity. And the fact that we have quite a significant reach through our own channels really does help with that domestic footprint and that awareness, greater awareness clearly at home, which makes our job a little easier.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Okay. I wonder if I could just ask a brief supplementary before we move on about Scotland's reputation, which is a sort of measurable indicator, and how that relates to something like the cultural offering and Scotland's culture and how that's perceived and how these things link in to what happens. Ms. Miller, I don't know if you want to go first on that one.
Yeah, I mean, obviously the real indication of from a kind of global reputation is through the Ant Holt study. That is the one study that we have where we can measure Scotland's reputation across a number of indicators against 60 other countries. What we do know is, I think, that as our tourism, our cultural heritage product is probably what is as one of the higher indicators in terms of what we are recognised for. And I think, you know, the work that has gone into and the investment that's gone into, for example, Scotland the Perfect Stage, our national event strategy, and the work to help events in particular in Scotland reach international markets. And, you know, it has been, I think, a hugely important part of building that cultural proposition. And obviously the storytelling that we do as Brand Scotland and promoting Scotland as a place to live, visit, work, study, and through obviously the content and storytelling that Visit Scotland does. I think all of that rich, both multimedia and written content, I think really does help to, build that reputation of Scotland, not just as a place to visit, but actually it kind of shows what it would be like to live and work in Scotland, because it's showing, you know, the kind of fantastic experiences you can enjoy in Scotland, the quality of the landscape and the environment and all of those things. So it serves many purposes.
The Cabinet Secretary has recently been talking also about the Global Scots networks and how important networks are. So I wonder if, again, international networks, there isn't a performance indicator for that. So I wondered if you could just give us a feeling of where we stand in that area, and if there was a measurement that could be applied to how effective those networks are.
Yeah, and that's an interesting one. I mean, I guess Global Scots and Diaspora, I mean, our ask of them is to do some of that storytelling and help also connect, you know, businesses in Scotland with, market opportunities. I think it would... It's definitely an area I think we could sharpen our indicators so that it's not just about necessarily how engaged they are, but we actually look at maybe some of the more outcome-focused measures rather than simply, I think, that just engagement metric, which I think is where we are just now.
I'm looking to the Mr. Salmoney. Do you want to speak about this?
Yes, thank you, Convener. So I think that... I would agree with the points that have just been made in the sense that if we're asking our diaspora or the networks that we have to do something for us or to be a vehicle for us, it's we can measure them, of course, but I suppose it's more important to measure both whatever our objectives were in the first place and then the outcomes of them, in a sense if they're the intermediary for whatever the Scottish Government or Scotland as a whole has as an objective and whatever outcome that is. And I think when we look at reputation and culture, it's not, in my perspective at least, not just about promoting culture on its own or even things like tourism and so on, even though those are both very important, but leveraging culture and reputation, using them as a catalyst for other aspects of how Scotland relates to the rest of the world. So what are other policy goals when it comes to external affairs or even other aspects? Things that reflect both our interests but also our values too. So that can be sure on trade and investment, which is aligns with our interests, but also values that are important to us in terms of democracy, the rule of law, human rights. We can use and leverage our reputation to advance all of those elements, ensure that they're aligned together, that what we're saying in terms of our values, in terms of our interests, and in terms of our policies can be buttressed by the extraordinarily fortunate good reputation that we have in the world. That's something that's an advantage to us. And I think that, and of course, we do capture some of that value, but I'm sure that we can capture more of it because there's a lot of value to draw on.
Mr. Williams, do you want?
I suppose just to add, I think the figures around reputation would be broadly in line with the feedback that we get from our members that are located internationally. I would add in education alongside culture is absolutely fundamental to that very strong reputation. I think it is one that we could capitalise on more. I mean, small countries do have or can develop quite a prominent role internationally in areas like arbitration and dispute resolution and so on. So, can we do more there, or can we do more in other areas? As regards networks, I think I think we would welcome a bit more kind of outcome focused metrics as well. I'm aware that the Global Scot Network has been expanded in recent times, but we do have some mixed feedback from members operating internationally as to whether they have a connection with Global Scot. Or if they know how to go about establishing a connection with a Global Scot. So as it expands further, I think there's a need to sharpen up, as Vicky's already said.
Ms. Shand.
Yeah, reputation is a really interesting one, and I think it is quite difficult to measure, and a lot of it is anecdotal. There's some clear evidence. So in the recent EY attractiveness survey, outside of London, Scotland is the most attractive place to invest in. And 16% of the top global investors would look to Scotland as one of their top markets. So reputationally, there is some evidence out there. I think the difficulty, as I say, is taking from anecdotal evidence into sort of, more outcomes. I think we also have to be very careful that reputationally we don't rely on a typical Scottish brand, i.e. St Andrew's Day and Burns Suppers. I think we have to be really careful that actually Scotland has a lot more to offer. When you think historically of the innovators that have come from Scotland, the daily disposable contact lens was invented here, the ATM was invented here. You know, the Scottish Government is investing really heavily in the space sector. There are some real opportunities, so I think we have to be very careful on how we balance the delicacy of what is and it has been and is great for Scotland, but actually what Scotland will look like in the next 10, 20, 50 years as well. With the Global Scots, we work very closely with a number of them. But again, I think we need to be careful we don't create a crowded market. We have global Scots. We will potentially have Scotland diaspora. We have export champions. We have international trade ambassadors. So this is quite a quagmire for businesses to understand, well, who do they go to? How do they go to them? What can they do for them? And what's the whole purpose? And I think when you open up to the entire Scotland diaspora, which would be incredible, but you're reaching out to millions of people, that's going to be very difficult, I think, at the early stage to consider what the outcomes may be. So for me, it would be, what's the purpose in the first place? And how do we avoid duplication of all these initiatives, which is sort of a variation on a theme?
So we've talked about a lot of the successes, and you mentioned the whisky industry earlier on, but for SMEs, do they have a different challenge to the sort of more established?
Yeah, very much so. So I think for small and medium-sized businesses, it's where to put the pin in the first place. Where do they start their journey? So if a small business comes to someone within our network, I'll give you a really good example. Ochil Fudge, you may have heard of them. So Ochil Fudge started in Alloa in their own kitchen, and they now trade globally. And ironically, it was partly because of the COVID pandemic that sort of forced them to look at e-commerce. So now they have 25 varieties of fudge and they trade all over the world, which is absolutely superb. But their point was, how do I start? Where do I start? If I want to open a restaurant in America, that's really vague. So how do they get the market research? Who do they know on the ground? Who can they rely on? And that's when some of the diaspora and the global net, a global Scot, can really come into their own. But it's even before then for small businesses. They don't know what they don't know. So we need to provide training on Incoterms, on commodity codes. We need to be providing pragmatic support on certificates of origin and ATA carnets and get them to understand the language. So for us, anything that governments can do to help reduce red tape and break down some of these barriers for small, medium businesses that will reduce man hours and resources will be hugely helpful.
Thank you. Yes, Mr. Sullivan.
On the point of St. Andrew's Day and so on, because that was linking to what I was trying to say earlier about culture and using it as a catalyst. So I can understand the reluctance of, in a sense, being pigeonholed in that sort of view of Scotland in terms of, St. Andrew's Day or the things of bagpipes and tartan and so forth. But my point is that we use that as a catalyst, as other countries do. You know, yes, you hold St. Andrew's Day celebrations, but you use it as an opportunity to bring business people together to promote space, for instance, or other aspects, as Ireland does, of course, extremely effectively with St. Patrick's Day and more recently St. Bridget's Day as well. I mean, as I imagine you'll be aware, on St. Patrick's Day, almost every government minister in Ireland is not in Ireland because they go all over the world to attend various St. Patrick's Day celebrations, and they use that to promote themselves. And again, it's not just about promoting trade investment that they do that. They also use it as an opportunity to promote what they see as Irish and European values too. So those are our vehicles, our tools of taking the cultural aspect and using it in a way which is productive, not just financially, of course financially, but in terms of other aspects as well. And that's what I suggest that we should do more of, I think.
Sorry, Ms. Miller, did you want to come in as well?
I absolutely just want to come in on that point and just to kind of say that our collective Brand Scotland strategy is very much about, I would summarise it as reinforce and challenge. And the reinforce is reinforce what people know that is iconic and that is world class about Scotland, but challenge the perceptions of what people don't know and the kind of innovative, progressive, inclusive aspects of that brand story. And so, you know, across all of the work that we do with Scottish Government, international colleagues, SDI, Creative Scotland, University of Scotland, we're all working to that Brand Scotland strategy and the principle of that reinforce and challenge so that we are telling the whole story and obviously very much positioning the Scotland that we are today.
Thank you. Mr. McPherson, you wanted a supplementary?
Thanks, Convener. It was just, Ms. Shand, you've talked about red tape twice, and I just wondered if there were any particular regulations that you wanted to emphasise. Are they devolved regulations or reserved? Because I'd just like to get a greater understanding of what you find prohibitive in that regard.
Not so much what we find prohibitive, I suppose, what businesses find prohibitive.
Pardon me, yes.
I think the global landscape changes politically quite frequently, and that causes challenges. So, you know, when we left the European Union, there were going to be changes and companies had lined up for those changes and then they were delayed. so things changed again, and then they were going to happen, and then there are more changes, and then the Windsor framework comes into place. So I think some of the difficulties with red tape is that the line constantly moves for small businesses and large businesses.
It's more reserved regulations that you're referring to with regard to exit from the European Union. Is that correct?
Some of that, but again, even influence. So, for example, the free trade agreements, the UK, Australian, UK, New Zealand free trade agreement came into place recently. Although that's a UK power, actually, there should be an opportunity for businesses in Scotland to participate and influence the outcome of these. It's really important that they do.
And I think that's a really I think that's a really important point, because obviously Chambers of Commerce operates throughout the UK, and indeed I've spoken with some of your colleagues from elsewhere in the UK in events past. So through the Chambers network, do you feel you're, as a Scottish voice, whether it's through your own organisation or directly to Whitehall departments, is the voice of Scottish business in terms of the opportunities that you talked about, but also the concerns that you may have, being heard through those forums and in those corridors and in those environments?
Not as much as we'd like. I think, you know, I always sort of say a bit like my school report, could do better, is it tends to be the outcome from businesses. And I think one of the challenges is, I suppose, if you were to create a product and try and take it internationally, if you've never done that before, then you would understand the challenges. And I think it's therefore very difficult. So there are opportunities for Scottish businesses to get involved, but I don't think they understand the true impact they can have.
So do you think the Scotland office and other UK departments that are in the Scotland office would therefore relay your concerns or points of recommendation? Do you think that there could be a better process there to make sure the voice of Scottish business is heard?
I think more engagement. I think initiatives like this are also very helpful. We're all organisations that sort of represent, you know, businesses as a whole. So I think that the more opportunities, the better. So we recently participated in the Scottish Affairs Committee about whether UK government can do more to promote Scotland. And our answer was unequivocally yes, of course they can. Yeah. So there are ministers from Scotland who have international trade visits, and there are ministers from the UK who have international trade missions.
And just on that, do you see value in Scottish ministers undertaking those overseas visits?
Yes. And again, that comes back to reputation. I think it's really important that they are seen. I attended Dubai Expo with Minister McKee at the time, and it was invaluable that he was there. I think if you're looking future to Future Expo and the likes of COP, government-to-government relationships are really, really important. But actually, it's businesses that do the trade, that export goods and services, that are looking for inward investment. So it's imperative that both the Scottish Government and UK Government engage with business. And the more open the doors are, and the more they listen, I think that's when they understand a bit more about the true red tape and some of the barriers. And again, it's different globally, so red tape is very challenging all over the world.
Thanks for all of that. And just one last question, if I may, convener. Just all of that considered, do you think, rather than UK government questioning Scottish government's international engagement, actually it would be better if both governments saw the value of international engagement and just worked collaboratively in the common interest of Scotland, and that, of course, includes Scottish business?
As an apolitical organisation, yes, absolutely. I think, as I say, there's duplication of effort, and it's a very crowded marketplace. And I mentioned earlier, you know, sort of export champions in one element, international trade ambassadors in another, global Scots, and that's the quagmire for business. I think simplification and stability. And I think, you know, UK government should be promoting Scotland as well as the other nations, I hasten to add. And Scotland does things which are very unique. And I think we also need to be able to forge ahead independently as well.
Yeah, so having our own voice in the room is a welcome addition rather than a complex duplication.
Yeah. Not an and or, yes. Yeah.
Thank you for that. Thank you. Appreciate it.
Thank you. I'm going to bring in Dr. Allen.
Thank you for that, and not that I'm going to ask you to comment on that, but that was an interesting conversation that Ben McPherson struck up there, because politically in this place, we are regularly told that it is not a good thing for Scottish ministers to engage with other countries about Scotland's business. So it's good to have that issue drawn out so effectively by Mr. McPherson there. But what I was going to ask you about was you mentioned overcoming peripherality, and obviously we're more peripheral now that we're not in the European Union. So, but you mentioned two countries, Ireland and Iceland, which both have an obvious diplomatic and political advantage in these matters. But what are the models? What are the comparator countries? What are the things we can learn from them in Scotland's approach internationally and trying to achieve the objectives that we're all looking at? You mentioned these countries, Mr.
Yes,
Salamone. I don't know if you want to come in
sure.
as well.
Yes, thank you, Dr. Allen. So there's a lot to say, isn't there? Just to come on to the previous point, yes, I hope that we could have a consensus that it's right for Scottish institutions, and it's not just the Scottish government, but also the Scottish Parliament, to engage with colleagues internationally. But just in terms of cooperation, obviously it requires both administrations to meet somewhere in the middle. And why not have an idea of joint trade missions between Scottish government ministers and UK government ministers promoting Scotland together? That sounds like a great idea to me. In terms of looking for other countries, you know, I mean, I suppose we want to look both at smaller states, smaller European states make sense, and also European sub-states, and we can learn from both of them. I think the committee has looked at this before. Yes, Ireland makes sense, sure. There's Iceland, sure. There are regions like German states or, Flanders or so on. But it can be a bit of a challenge sometimes, I think, particularly with Flanders and Wallonia, because they have such a high degree of autonomy, which to me is not as comparable to Scotland's case. But so in 60 seconds or so, what can we learn from these countries? I suppose one is that, they perhaps maybe have a clear sense of not what their strengths are, but what core strengths, be it in economic or soft power terms, they want to focus on. Which ones they want to prioritize? How do they take those and build themselves a profile in the world that allows them to have those kinds of vehicles to promote their interests and their values? I suppose an example for Ireland's case would be how they, over a long period of time, again, this isn't directly applicable to Scotland, built the capacity to win a seat on the UN Security Council and then use that as a platform for them. Now, again, that's not directly comparable to Scotland because Scotland's not a state, but does demonstrate that if you want to achieve a longer-term objective, you need to be willing to have a longer-term horizon. Ireland was waiting 15 years for that UN Security Council seat, and it means that, they would need to have a higher degree of cross-party agreement on what those objectives were for their country and how they're going to achieve them across governments. And I think if we look in the Scottish context, it's not just about, what are the priorities of whatever the government of the day is for external affairs in any dimension, be it trade or otherwise, but to what extent is there cross-party consensus on these are the core priorities for Scotland as part of the UK and the world, and those will transcend any one party or administration?
Thank you. And I can't remember if it was yourself, Mr. Williams, that raised this point, but it was the crossover between culture and wider democratic and maybe it was yourself, Mr. Salamone, the crossover between how Scotland projects itself culturally and its wider democratic or human rights or other aspirations or messages it wants to get across in those spheres. We've talked in this committee before about, and some of you have mentioned the issue about Scotland's potential for dispute resolution. Where does how we project ourselves culturally and how we project these values, where do they cross over and what can we do more in that sphere?
Sure. I think it's a complex question, a very interesting one. I think it's just that I suppose it's always valuable if we try to look at ourselves from outside. And I guess that's not a novel concept, but to say that I think a lot of what defines Scotland we just assume or take for granted, so that we are an established democracy, that we pioneered some of the principles of modern economics, that we have a strong rule of law tradition and respect for human rights and so on. Those are some core values. And then there is the things that people know about Scotland already in terms of cultural icons. And that we have a reputation globally for our universities and for education generally. Again, these are large principles and concepts that can sometimes be difficult to link together, but I think we can still link them together in ways that allow us to advance what we want to advance in the world. And again, sure, that is about advancing our interests. Of course, we want more trade, we want more investment, we want better jobs and so on. We want those things, we don't have to deny them, but at the same time that we also want to see a world that reflects the kind of values that we have. We want to see greater democracy. We want to see the rule of law not just advanced but upheld in many parts of the world. And again, I know I may be sounding too vague here, but I'm sure that, you know, and maybe that comes to my point about that we need to have some clear objectives and principles and you decide which of those aspects you want to prioritize and focus on. But it's not just about a question of raw metrics of FDI and so forth. It's also about what kind of world do we want to see that reflects what we think is good for our economy in the long term, but also reflects the kind of political systems that we want. And it's not about saying that we would have huge influence on those, but we shouldn't deny the influence that we can have. Sorry, that might be a bit vague. But
not at all. That's very helpful. And finally, Convener, dispute resolution about, is there more that we can do in that sphere that Scotland could aim to do to bring people together in Scotland for that purpose?
I know there was a proposal a few years back to establish an international centre for arbitration in Scotland, and I must confess that I'm not certain as to the progress that was made with it. It was certainly one that we supported, and I think there was UK and Scottish Government interest in it, with a particular focus around energy, given Scotland's reputation globally in that industry. But I'm sorry, I can't give you
So maybe if I just sort of segue from, I guess, this is the question of dispute resolution in terms of arbitration and also dispute resolution in terms of peace building. And I know that was previously an area of interest for the Scottish Government. I'm not entirely sure if it still is. I think that Scotland as a global peace builder is an interesting concept, sure, but perhaps linked to what some of my colleagues have said previously in other sectors. I think we need to be cognizant of the global landscape and what others are doing, which and this was a roundabout way of saying that peace building is a crowded space. There are plenty of countries, including plenty of European countries, who are already in that domain and have made that part of their presence in the world, from Norway to Sweden to Ireland, even to Iceland and other countries, big and small, usually smaller countries, because they have a less of a geopolitical baggage, which makes it difficult to be a mediator, if you like. So could Scotland be a global peace builder, perhaps? But I would think we need to take into account that crowded space and see, is that really the place where, if we want to have a global profile, is that really the one that's right for us? I'm not entirely convinced it is.
Okay, thank you.
Can Mr. Ruskell join us remotely? Hopefully.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. As a committee, we've taken quite a lot of evidence in recent weeks around, you know, what kind of makes a good global citizen. And I think a thing that's come through a lot has been the importance of Scotland's role as a climate leader and in taking international action on climate change. And also credibility is an important part of that. So I'm just wondering if you see an inherent sort of contradiction in a way, because, you know, a lot of the evidence that I've read from yourselves coming to this committee today and comments you've made about international aviation and the need to, you know, increase the number of international flights and open up new routes and increase visitor numbers, does put us then, you know, in complete contradiction against the work that we're trying to do to show climate leadership. So, you know, without there being a really credible path towards developing sustainable aviation fuels, is there not an inherent acknowledgement there that kind of business growth and that international connectivity using aviation is going to set us against those climate objectives? So I'm just interested in how do you kind of square that? And I think, Vicky, you said earlier on that, you know, what you're now seeing in the sector is a pivot away from domestic tourism. And that's something that Visit Scotland is very much going to lean into, recognise that's the way the market's going, and then switch really away from investing in attracting people to have holidays at home and really sort of, you know, lean into that international market. So, you know, do you acknowledge that there are contradictions in there and potential credibility issues, and how do you attempt to square that? Vicky, do you want to start with that?
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you for the question. When I said pivot away from domestic, it was more in terms of the balance of Visit Scotland resources on, or particularly our media budget. The domestic market actually remains critically important to the sector, because it does drive obviously volume of visits, but actually importantly really addresses issues of seasonality and particularly regional spread. You know, if you take areas like the south of Scotland, they will see more domestic visitors than they do international. So it's not that we're pivoting away, it's just that when you've got more limited resources, it's about where's the areas of opportunity, and clearly from a global perspective, you need more resources to get a return on investment, and particularly in things like media investment. I think what therefore is critically important, because you're right, our geography dictates that an element of, you know, we do need to increase our connectivity if we are going to attract more high value international visitors. They are lower in volume, but they stay longer and spend more. And so that is obviously important to remember. The key thing, therefore, is to us to continue to work really closely with the industry to help them on their journey to net zero. And that has now become a significant focus. It is a kind of strategic priority of Scotland Outlook 2030, which is the National Tourism Strategy. There is a joint project across all of the enterprise agencies to look at it, called Tourism Net Zero, and that's about really combining our resources to provide a toolkit to industry to help them develop their own climate action plans, and to ensure, therefore, that we, decarbonise the whole tourism supply chain, so that when a visitor is in Scotland, obviously we are minimising that carbon footprint. So I think that has to be absolutely our focus, and it is absolutely a kind of key priority. Does that answer your question?
Well, I think you kind of acknowledge that there is perhaps a bit of a contradiction there, and it's how you square that. I mean, I was going to ask you then around, you know, other ways to other transport modes to connect Scotland. And, you know, there's been renewed interest in, bringing back a Rosyth to continental Europe ferry service. I'm not sure quite where we are with that in terms of that being a well-defined offering for tourists. And, you know, you'll see the trends in continental Europe as well around the growth in overnight trains. And particularly the action of some governments, like the French government, to restrict domestic flights, but to very much, push travel and tourism in more of that direction. Obviously, we have challenges there, not least because of Brexit. But I'm interested in to what extent the Scottish tourism sector is really looking at connectivity beyond aviation. Because when I read your submission to the committee, it was all about let's have more flights. And there didn't seem to be much in there around more lower carbon, perhaps more future-proofed forms of interconnectivity.
Yeah, and I would say that actually the discussions that we've had with the industry leadership group that has been set up by the minister and minister co-chairs that group to look at, I guess, what are the kind of game-changing areas that need to happen to make tourism in Scotland more sustainable, is that whole area of kind of transport, and particularly I would say yes, ferries particularly important from Europe, that particularly for that kind of European touring type visitor, but also it's then train travel within Scotland being particularly important. And actually I think a lot more that needs to be done there to look at how we have integrated ticketing. There are a number of maybe barriers and equally opportunities there around public transport, active travel, which we would like to see continued investment in order to provide a better visitor experience. And as you say, to ensure that actually we can offer other modes of transport as a way of getting around Scotland, which will obviously ultimately benefit those sustainability goals.
Yeah. Okay. If I could move to Shona then on a similar theme. I was reading your submission and, there's obviously a lot of excitement from business about COP28 and, the business opportunities there. I think you said it's one of the largest global moments and, the business will be trying to make sense of those opportunities in the same way as you did with the Dubai Expo 2020. I mean, I suppose at one level, the COP process, when I was last in Glasgow, COP26, did feel like a big trade show. That's not to diminish the importance of that, because it's clearly an important function, but it does then raise questions about credibility in relation to the business sector's engagement in the COP process, and I guess kind of where you draw the line. So when I was wandering around COP26 and the various hundreds and hundreds of stands that were there in Glasgow, I saw some stands from countries that were clearly stretching it in terms of credibility with the kind of businesses that were being presented and the genuine sustainability of some of the offerings there and some of what the countries were wanting to promote from their own individual sectors. I'm wondering like how you find that sort of line of credibility within Scotland as well. So is this an opportunity for everybody to come to, COP28 and to present their goods and their services, or are there particular key themes where, the Scottish Government will be saying, look, this is actually our sort of contribution in terms of climate change, in terms of goods and services, but there may be others which are more questionable, and I certainly saw some questionable promotion at COP26, which was widely described as greenwashed by others.
Thank you for the question. So I would say probably two parts to this. One is from a Scottish Chamber's perspective, and on behalf of the Chamber network of about 30 chambers, we are very systematic in our approach of sort of one to many. As I say, we sort of directly support about 13,000 businesses. So we very much look to a trading nation for sort of guidance on the right markets and the right sectors. But we do support businesses of every sector and every size, as long as they're sort of entrepreneurial, ambitious and passionate. So from our own perspective, when we run trade missions, we are very aware of our own sort of a carbon footprint. So a lot of our work is done virtually. Online, which is a great, again, COVID was quite useful in that sense. It allowed us to sort of become experts in these technologies. So a lot of pre-engagement for initiatives is done through technology, through Zoom and Teams, which is really, really helpful. It allows us to get ahead of the game, but it does avoid us sort of getting on planes to travel around the world. So COP is slightly different. COP for us is not a trade show. It absolutely isn't. It's about government, linking in with government sort of come together. But part of what we want to do around COP this year, working very closely with the Scottish Government and some of the teams, is how do we ensure that exporters are aware of some of the net zero challenges that are sort of being replaced and consumers and businesses around the world and their expectations and how we can positively influence that. So I go back to one of my sort of earlier comments around innovators in Scotland. Some of the innovations which are coming out and the green skills which we're going to require are really, really important. So we don't see global events like COP, for example, as being taking a typical trade mission out to the UAE. It's very much about highlighting the Scottish Government and UK Government's messages around the importance of climate change, Scotland's ambitious targets for being net zero much earlier than other businesses. And I think that's the angle we're looking at for that.
Okay, that's useful. My last question then is, we received some evidence from Scottish International Development Alliance. And, they were proposing kind of extending the sort of outcomes and indicators for how we measure Scotland's, impact in terms of international work. And I think they were sort of taking a bit more of a wellbeing economy approach. So, they were wanting the inclusion of fossil fuel extraction, export, the arms trade, the socio-economic impact of Scotland's supply chains, the material footprint of Scotland and Scotland's business on the rest of the world. I'm just wondering if that kind of emerging consensus around a wellbeing economy and what that means, it would be something that you would inherently welcome, or some of your members might have a concern around. Or maybe just go to Gareth actually next, and then back to Anthony and Shona and Vicky.
So it's more generally. We welcome a focus on well-being. We're involved in the Scottish Government's New Deal for Business work, and we're chairing the subgroup on the well-being economy, along with Scottish Business in the Community, which is looking at how businesses articulate their contribution to a wellbeing economy. So very much signed up to that as a priority. I think in terms of the international picture, we have done a lot of work around business purpose as a theme, established a commission which produced a report last year, and we've been talking to the Canadian government over recent months about whether they would establish a similar commission, which, you know, again, does link into wellbeing, given that they're one of the wellbeing economy governments. So I think there's potential for us to make progress around that, and that obviously does engage the private sector very strongly in that activity. There is a bit of a risk about creating too many additional indicators, although certainly some of those that you've mentioned around carbon impact of supply chains, I think, are very important. We wouldn't see a contradiction between international trade and climate change. Clearly, there can be tension there, but we're keen that new free trade agreements, for example, could include climate commitments between countries, and that there's a very strong emphasis around trade and low carbon goods and services in that. I mentioned in Brussels recently, and I think it was interesting in terms of some of the comments that we had from European Commission that they were very supportive of kind of our vision for the Scottish economy, which is very much aligns with the national strategy for economic transformation. But the one omission from our work, which I think also is true for the blueprint, which is an increasing priority for them, was around access to critical raw materials and the impact on supply chain as global trade patterns change. I thought that was quite an interesting reflection. We did talk a lot about where we can continue to work together with the EU, and I think there is a very major opportunity around net zero, the EU's Green Industrial Deal. Where does Scotland potentially plug into the net zero supply chains that that's going to create within Europe? And there is certainly a strong interest in the work that Scottish Government has been leading around just transition as well within the EU and more broadly. Related to that point, there was certainly a lot of talk around carbon border adjustment mechanisms. Obviously, the EU has been looking at that, and so is the UK. I think Scottish Government has done some early work around that, and I think it's an area that we would be supportive of, particularly to try and reduce the carbon impact of trade and potentially increase the opportunities around reshoring of supply chains within our country.
Yeah. Anthony, I don't know if you've got anything to add on any of those topics. We'll go back to Vicky.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Ruskell. Yes, I'd like to come back to your first question on what is a good global citizen in practice, and how can we balance challenges and so forth. I think to me there are two key ways that I would want to define what being a good global citizen means. I think one is both the alignment and balance of values and interests. And of course, that can be a challenge, as you outlined, and I'll explain them after having said what they are. And the second is aligning and balancing what Scotland does domestically with what it does internationally. So on the first point, I think every country, of course, when they're engaging externally, want to promote themselves and look good. I mean, that's a very natural tendency, and it's quite right. But at the same time, I think there is some value in being honest about the challenges and trade-offs. So if we speak a lot about Ireland. Ireland, has a strong reputation for its, commitment to multilateralism and peace and conflict resolution and other things that it finds favourable just in terms of sentiment and culture. But at the same time, Ireland, as we mentioned, is a hub for global aviation and the fossil fuel emissions linked to it. And of course, Ireland has been a haven for multinational corporations who were keen to save on tax, for instance. So those are a bit of a challenge. In Scotland's case, yes, we want to say that we are a leader in combating climate change, and we have ambitious climate change targets. We also have a history as a fossil fuel exporter. And then, of course, as I understand, we have not always met our targets. That's contradictory information, but every country faces those contradictions. I think in the UK context, this goes both for UK government and for the Scottish government, the tendency is to ignore all the negatives and only focus on the positives. But that kind of narrative is perhaps not persuasive, because we know that that's not the whole picture. So I think, that's not to say that you overemphasize the challenges or the negatives, but I think you should try and balance them and have some honesty about that when you're engaging with external partners. And that also means accepting criticism where it's warranted from other countries or other partners too. It's not sustainable, I think, for Scotland or for the UK, for any country to expound on virtues and values that we say are important when other countries aren't living up to standards, and not accepting any criticism for anyone else if we're not meeting those same standards ourselves. I'm not pointing out any particular area, but as a general principle, I think that's the way, if you want to build that kind of credibility that you were speaking about. It's about, based on that honesty of the challenges, how do you balance them, and then also accepting criticism where it's warranted as much as giving it to countries when they don't uphold any particular standard.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, thank you very much for that. Vicky, Shona, do you want to come back on any final thoughts?
Yeah, I think maybe just building on Anthony's point there, I would agree, and again, maybe just some of the work that we've been doing as Brand Scotland is to build the proof points around the evidence that we have that Scotland is a good global citizen, that it is open, welcoming, inclusive, progressive, and kind of our net zero journey, and providing a toolkit for industry and partners to also be able to talk about what those proof points are and being very honest about what is still work in progress. So I think that is very important. The evidence to support the story is really important. I think specifically on the tourism side, I talked about the kind of outcomes that we are looking at across the four S's of spread, spend, sustainability, and satisfaction. And when I'm talking about satisfaction, it's not just visitor satisfaction, it's actually about, I guess, industry and community. And I think what we are seeing is that as we reset and we rebuild towards a kind of more responsible and sustainable visitor economy, it's very important that we take into account the well-being of the community, and that we get that right balance of visitors for each community in Scotland. So we are starting to look at, well, how do we measure that community aspect and that community impact, and make sure that we get that right too. And from an industry perspective, obviously things like Fair Work and that is going to be important in terms of positioning the industry as an attractive industry from which to work in and attract more people in Scotland into the industry. So I think we also need to think about outcomes in those areas too.
Yeah, thanks. Shona?
I was going to tell you a little bit about Brand Scotland, but that's okay. Vicky's done that, which actually, I guess, sort of highlights the importance of it. And it's really interesting. So in our relationship, our international trade partnership with the Scottish Government, we have some sort of soft measurement outcomes and slightly harder ones. And one of the things we're starting to ask businesses who come on our trade missions is about their Fair Work principles and the trade principles. Because actually, there are some things which are easily measured, such as, value of opportunity, number of jobs created, and that's exactly what we should be measuring. But actually, we also need to understand the impact some of these will have on businesses. Again, particularly smaller businesses who maybe don't quite understand the implications of having a sort of well-being strategy for their work. So trying to help them at the sort of entrepreneurial stage, startup stage, actually to get some of these principles embedded in their business, to tackle the domestic market and then to go globally. And I think at that stage, when they're looking at global markets, it's intrinsically embedded in their organisation that actually it's more than just hard outcomes, that there are sort of bigger implications in order to be a good global citizen.
Okay, thanks very much. Very useful. Back to you, convener.
Thank you. Mr. Cameron.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the panel. Just picking up on that last point about a good global citizen, and we heard evidence about this last week from the Scottish Council on Global Affairs. And it's obviously a very subjective term, and I think we can all agree on some sort of basic norms that a good global citizen should adhere to. And we've touched on, Mark touched on climate, for example. Do you think it's a useful concept for us to promote, notwithstanding the kind of, the good intentions behind it? But do you think it's useful as a concept? Can I start with Anthony?
Certainly. Thank you, Mr. Cameron. Yes, I think that a good global citizen could be useful if we had something to define it, in a sense. You know, it's very admirable to say that Scotland and the rest of the UK, in terms of their engagement with the world, should be guided by the principle of contributing positively and so forth. But I want to know what that means in practice. Does it mean, you know, that we want to advocate particular values that we want to see in the world? I've mentioned some. You know, there can still be headline principles. It doesn't have to be in granular detail. But if we're saying it's the promotion of the rule of law and democracy and so on, that's fine. It doesn't have to be extraordinarily detailed about a particular country or particular mode of democracy, what have you. Is that about the kind of trade that we want to do or kind of trade partners we want to have? And how will we balance situations where, you know, in pure economic terms, trade with a particular partner, a particular industry would be beneficial to us, but in terms of our values, it wouldn't be, and so we're going to have to find somewhere in the middle. Or, other aspects of who our priorities are, of who we want to work with in the world, and to what end. I think if we could link those to a meaning of good global citizen, then sure, it would be a useful concept. But in the absence of that, it's a bit vague to understand what it means in practice.
Gareth, do you have a view?
I don't have much to add here. I suppose what I would say is that lots of our members, lots of businesses are increasingly mindful of their role, the risks that exist. To them, from their reputation and when they're operating internationally, including their supply chains and the impact that that may have on whether people are willing to buy from them, and ultimately on their social license to operate. So, you know, I think it's in the mind of businesses, it does have a significance for countries as well, but I can answer in detail about exactly how that should be measured and so on.
Vicky?
I think I would really just reinforce, Anthony's point and the points I made earlier. That it's yes, maybe I think it is helpful, but we probably need to better define it, and then it's the evidence that's backing it up with the why, what are those proof points, and being very clear about what they are. I think that will stand us in good stead.
Sharon, do you have anything to
inclined add? To just agree with all the aforementioned points.
Can I move on to the question of Scotland's international presence in terms of the offices, and really to ask this, as a panel, are we in the right places in terms of the world? We're not in the global south. We're not, I don't think, in South America. I don't think we're in Africa, with the exception of Malawi. Do you think we should be, and should we sort of redirect, refocus? We can't be everywhere. Resources are limited. But Gareth, I think I might start with you, given your remit.
I mean, I think that it's an interesting question, and resources are clearly a consideration, particularly at this time. I think we do lack a presence in sub-Saharan Africa. I mentioned that already. Latin America would be another location, but you know. At the same time, we want to grow our presence even within existing markets like the US, and there is a focus on how within a continental market can we take advantage of opportunities that might exist within an individual state. So I think it would be something that would have to be developed over a period of time, taking into account other priorities like the need to ensure that we're continuing to engage effectively within the EU.
Vicky, would you like to comment? Yeah,
from a visit perspective, and also when I look even at kind of likes of business events, the US, France and Germany have consistently been our priority markets, and we see the largest both volume and value. So from our perspective, that's where the focus of our resources are. Therefore, that's where we would want the priorities to be.
Okay. And Sharon?
That's a really interesting question, and I think it would probably, again, businesses will answer this very, very differently. I would agree about it. So Africa, we always talk about Africa as though it's a country and not a continent, and that in itself comes with some challenges. And I know you had some people sort of on the ground there, and that's changed a little bit. What I would say is I think short term the answer is probably yes. But it's the longer term view, and again, that comes back to the stability. So looking longer term, looking at new and emerging markets, actually, how can you also use partner organisations to help you get ahead, to know where the right places are to go in the first place? I think that's probably going to be invaluable. And again, you'll have Global Scots on ground and other sort of partner organisations, and even through our international chamber network, there's sort of, 40 million companies in over 100 countries in global chambers of commerce. So there's already boots on the ground, so to speak, that can help you identify where these new markets are. So short term, long term, slightly different view.
Yeah, I just think that's really interesting, because I think markets do change, and as we know, and some will fall away and some will grow. And I suppose it's trying to keep tabs on that as it changes. It's really and actually really important dimension of this. Mm-hmm. Anthony, do you have anything to add to that?
Yes, I do. I think that maybe there are two elements. One is where and how many the offices the Scottish Government has in the world, and I suppose the other is sort of the international presence more generally. And in terms of the Scottish Government's representative offices, I think that their placement would depend on what their strategic objectives and core purposes are, and as I've mentioned in previous evidence to the committee, I'm not clear on what those objectives are. I mean, if it truly is just on the basis of trade and investment, for instance, then that leads you to maybe one conclusion. If it's on basis of engaging on policy issues, which can relate to trade and investment, of course, but maybe on other dimensions of EU policy in Brussels, or of course wider UK policy in London, or what have you. If you want to be connected to particular countries that you think is important for the global policy environment that would affect the Scottish economy, for instance, you'd make different choices. So I think if you had that clarity on what the aims of the network as a whole were, you could decide where you wanted the offices to be. So for instance, if the aim was to have strategic connections with the EU, you'd be wondering, well, there's an office in France and Germany, but there isn't one in Italy, there isn't one in Spain, there isn't one in the Netherlands, for instance, but there is one in Denmark now, which is fine. So is that the focus on the Nordics? Okay. Does that make sense for what our overarching aims for trade and investment or other aspects are? I'm not sure. I think if I were to offer a perspective, I think a focus on Europe, so both the EU and non-EU, and North America makes sense. I think that when you're talking about offices in particular, I would caution against overextending the presence, both in terms of the physical offices, but also in terms of sort of time and effort and resources. I don't think it makes sense to have offices all over the world at this stage. If we're talking about, we need to have priorities, and if our priorities include Europe and North America and South America and Africa and Asia, those aren't priorities. That's the whole world. So that's the offices. And I suppose of international presence, well, I think we need to see how Scotland can gain from what's available. So yeah, Scottish Government has its own offices, sure, but what can be gained and maximised from the UK Government's substantial diplomatic presence, which of course is one of the largest diplomatic presences in the world. I'm not saying that we don't already do this in a trade perspective. I'm saying in terms of a government policy perspective, we can gain from the Scottish Government's network and we can gain from the UK Government's network.
I'm glad you mentioned that, because I wasn't going to, but I noted the questions from Ben McPherson earlier, and I don't think it's worth revisiting the kind of much well-documented sort of arguments that have been had in recent months. But I think, and I think for the sake of balance, it is worth stating that I don't think the UK government have ever said that Scottish government shouldn't have an international presence, shouldn't promote trade. I think the argument has been about policy, particularly, and the limits of devolved and reserved powers. That aside, would you agree that whether it's for trade, whether it's for development, whether it's for tourism, it would be better for both the Scottish government and the UK government to work together to promote Scotland? Is that a fair comment? You're all nodding your heads, but if anyone wants to go any observations on how that dynamic works. I mean, we know that, for instance, that some international offices of the Scottish government are actually in UK embassies, for example.
And I wouldn't see that as a duplication, for instance. I mean, it's clear that, the Scottish team, for instance, in the German, in the German office, so the Scottish government international innovation investment hub in the UK embassy in Germany, for instance, they can understand the needs and priorities of Scottish businesses, for instance, and focalise that in tandem where relevant with what the UK government is doing in Germany. And to me, that's complementary, it's not duplicative. But in terms of cooperation, yes, I very much hope that the Scottish government and the UK government can continue their existing cooperation on international affairs and indeed improve on that. But as I mentioned in my written evidence, I think, and certainly in my comments earlier, that requires both governments to be willing to meet each other in the middle and to compromise. And that could be a challenge, of course, in any aspect of where there's overlap between the two administrations. But I think that it's quite important for external partners, because it can be confusing if the two governments are not on the same page on a particular aspect. That doesn't mean that there can't be political or policy differences. Of course, there will always be those differences. In fact, that's the purpose of devolution. But I mean in terms of if we're talking about partners who are wanting to understand where they should go for a particular service or whatnot. Yes, of course, the two governments should always try and work together. That cooperation exists, but I'm sure we could always do better. And I suppose the core point I underlined there is that requires both the UK government to be willing to meet the Scottish government in some cases, and some cases for the Scottish government to meet the UK government. It's not one-directional.
Does anyone else have observations, Gareth? Yeah.
Probably wouldn't want to comment on the politics, but I would observe that on an operational level, I think Scottish government and now the Department for Business and Trade and Scottish Development International are working well together. They both sit on our International Business Committee, and we can see that in those discussions, and certainly we get pretty positive feedback about what's happening externally as well. I think I admitted to say earlier that when we were talking about SDI's offices, that we do have the UK offices overseas as well, and we need to make more of them. I was speaking to a member yesterday who told me that in the last few months that they had been contacted twice by DIT to arrange trade missions to overseas markets and taken a group of companies, and that those had proved very effective visits for those companies. So I think certainly since DIT established a presence in Scotland, those links are being strengthened.
I would just again agree that cooperation is particularly helpful. And just on the tourism side, just to explain that we also have and benefit from a unique relationship with Visit Britain. So we have a strategic framework with Visit Britain, and that gives me the opportunity to influence the role that they play in promoting Scotland internationally, because obviously they have significant resources in terms of obviously international marketing, but also actually people in market that we don't have, and that is particularly important. Their resources are particularly important in terms of helping us to establish and use their networks, particularly with travel trade and other intermediaries in market, helping us to connect tourism businesses in Scotland with those networks. So I have the opportunity to influence them in terms of how they position Scotland, but also the role they undertake to make sure that they are helping businesses in Scotland connect with those networks, and that is particularly important.
Yeah, I think it's very important they work together to avoid fragmentation and confusion for businesses to understand quite simply who and where they go to for help. Businesses are just happy to get help and support, and I think we need to be careful from an investor point of view that there's not a perception that actually the governments aren't cooperating. I think certainly I meet with DBT and SDI regularly, and it's very clear there's a lot more collaboration and conversations happening. And again, the global teams as well, when I talk to them, it seems to be a lot less fragmented and a lot more partnership opportunity. And it's the right direction. We just all need to build on it.
Thank you. It's very powerful points. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Just on those points, all the evidence that we took when we did our investigation to the international offices was positive, and the good work, the complementary work, everything that you've just spoken about was there. We also had the British Council, for instance, saying they would welcome more offices and efforts opening up over there. But domestically and the discourse, and you touched on it there, Shant, it is, you know, we hear terms like pretend embassies and waste of money, and, you know, and then, you know, the wider, does that intergovernmental strain at the moment, if put it that way, does that break through into the perception internationally? And for the rest of the UK, is Scotland the only country that is experiencing this kind of tension, or is it shared by both the Welsh governments and Northern Ireland as well? I don't know if anyone wants to comment.
I probably couldn't answer the last segment. I'm not aware of any feedback about, certainly from businesses, about fake embassies. That's not something that's been fed through to us. I think, as I say, businesses ultimately want to know, who do I know in country? And they will reach out regardless of whether it's DBT or SDI. That they just need someone to offer them help. It's where can I win contracts? How do I find out the information? And I think, interestingly, I asked a business just to sort of, you know, Google what they would look for. And interestingly, when you Google International Trade Support Scotland, the first three pages are all universities about students, which is great. And it means they're doing their SEO particularly well. But actually, there was nothing about business on the first few pages. And SDI, I think, was in about page three, page four. And we were a little bit behind. So there's possibly a little bit of work there to make sure that actually when businesses are looking, as I say, they don't mind where the help is. They just need the help.
Thank you. Yes?
I think that, you know, intergovernmental disagreements when it comes to Scotland's or the Scottish government's engagement with the world are not helpful. But I wouldn't say, from at least from my perspective, that's something that, you know, has filtered through to businesses per se. I think that's something that maybe preoccupies the political level domestically. But I'm not sure how much it affects people, particularly outside Scotland or outside the UK. Nevertheless, you know, if those tensions persist, it could have an impact on businesses. And I think that the best solution is for the two governments to try to work together. And you know, when, for instance, I've mentioned in my previous evidence about a new intergovernmental agreement between the two administrations or all the devolved administrations on the UK government, which set out perhaps more clearly in the post-Brexit context how Scotland and where relevant Wales and Northern Ireland engage internationally and how that fits with what the UK government is doing. But I hope that we can move to, as perhaps my colleagues have alluded to, a more constructive approach in the space, because that's what, you know, it would benefit Scotland and the rest of the UK the most.
Thank you. Anyone else want to comment? You don't have to. Thanks. Mr. McPherson.
Thanks, Convener. And please excuse me, panel. I'm just going to take us back to a few points earlier. There was some discussion around a presence in Africa, and this can be an open question to come back on if you don't have an answer now, but the Scottish Government has an international development presence in Malawi, but also in Zambia and Rwanda as well. And as part of the considerations going forward, it would just be interesting if there was a particular city or country where particularly business interests thought that a Scottish Government presence would be helpful and appropriate and useful. So that was my first question. And my second question, again, going back to a point that we discussed some moments ago around Scotland being a good global citizen, without meaning to be overly semantic. I wondered if there was any thought that a more inclusive and helpful approach might be to think of Scotland promoting good global citizenship amongst its domestic population and also more widely. Again, any thoughts would be interesting.
Yes, so I'm maybe I leave it to my colleagues to specify where which cities or countries might be interesting for a business perspective for a Scottish Government presence, but on the question of citizenship versus citizens and so on, yes, I think that it's certainly possible that the principle of good global citizenship, as opposed to being Scotland being a good global citizen, could be useful, but I think that we still need to define what that means in practice. And you know, maybe have we faced some of the same challenges that we might face on the previous question. But I suppose it does link to something which I might have said before when I was trying to offer my definition of what a good global citizen is, which is to say it's not just about balancing values and interests, but also about ensuring alignment between domestic policy and external policy, which is to say that, you know, if, for instance, peace building were an area of importance for the Scottish Government globally, that we also take due account of how we promote peace building within Scotland as well, or indeed on other aspects of our external affairs policy, that we match with what we say others should do with what we do. And I'm not saying that this doesn't happen. I'm saying that has to be an intrinsic part of how we would want to promote good global citizenship and ensuring the kind of credibility that we would have to be able to make the claims that we were making. And I suppose that leads me back to that core point, which is to say, you know, if citizenship, it's not, you know, just about what we want others to do, but what we're doing ourselves and making sure that we're honest where we succeed in upholding the values that we have, and also honest in areas where we fall short. And I think that's the core sort of, you know, basis of the credibility to kind of make that kind of advocacy globally.
Thank you.
I don't have an immediate response on where you would locate. I suppose you would want to look at those markets that were most significant now and offered most growth opportunities. So obviously we've got very strong interest in the energy sector in Africa, and that might come into consideration along with other important sectors of the economy. And you'd want to be looking at factors about connectivity with the rest of the continent, but I wouldn't have an immediate favourite to offer there. And on the not much to add on the other point as well. I mean, I suppose we have some interest in the development of global skills, if you want to put it that way. Within the education system, and I know that's something that there's been some thought around how that's tracked. I think the PISA potentially has an experimental measure in relation to that, and you know, I think it's something that our business members are keen to see advance, because we want people to have those kind of skills, but. Nothing more specific than that at this stage.
No problem. Thanks, Mr. Williams. I don't feel you have to answer if you've got nothing more to add. Okay, thanks, Camille.
I think that exhausts questions from the committee this morning. Can I thank you all for your attendance once again to this inquiry? And on that note, I will close this session and we go into private session as a committee. Thank you.